graphic audio. A movie in your mind.
Graphic Audio presents Rylee Adamson 9, Rising Darkness, by Shannon Mayer. Narrated by Nora Achrati, Shanta Parasuraman, and Chris Genebach, and performed by a full cast. Remember, my child, that the darkest hour of all is the hour before the day breaks. Irish proverb.
The scent of death filled the air. I rubbed the back of my hand over my mouth, fighting the churning roll of my stomach. Around me, bodies were strewn about on cots, like dolls tossed from a child's toy chest. A tight band circled my chest. The anxiety I'd fought for the last 6 months surging upward, choking off my air. There was no way we could help everyone. No way to stop the raging plague. I walked as if in a dream, my eyes taking in what was in front of me for the first time in a long time. Pustules littered the bodies. Moans rumbled in rattling chests. Pale, thin skin pulled tightly from the inability to swallow around the pox inside the throat. But we weren't here to try and save these children. Not really. We were here to make sure they didn't become possessed. These were the ones the demons would take over in a few short days, if they didn't die first. Nurses moved between the beds. Here and there, a parent sat with a child. There was nothing any of them could do. The world was being decimated at a rate the World Health Organization couldn't keep up with. A resurgence of smallpox had spread as only a demon-driven disease could. At least, that was what Deanna had said, and I had no reason not to believe her. The demons had started it, sent it forth. Even though most of them were now locked in the deepest level of the veil, the demons who had been cut off and stuck on this side of the veil were keeping the disease alive and well. Dressed as a volunteer with my yellow name tag, I moved to the child closest to me and laid a hand on her head. Hello, my name is Pamela. She barely registered I was there. I wondered if she had any family left. A flash of movement stopped my musing. In front of me stood Liam, a sad smile on his lips, watching me, seeing through me. I closed my eyes, counted to 10, and opened them again. He was gone, and I could breathe once more. I knew it was just in my head, but it felt real, and it scared me. The little girl beside me shifted. Healing was the weakest of my abilities, yet Deanna asked me to keep trying. Deanna kept pushing me to try and do things that I either couldn't or didn't want to learn. I stroked the little girl's head, focusing my magic on repairing the damage within her body. I yanked at the magic, forcing it to do my bidding, stuffing it into the little girl. Within seconds, the effort brought sweat to my face. Damn you, Deanna. I am terrible at this. Why would you make me try to heal anyone? The little girl's skin lightened to a healthy pink, and the pustules faded to tiny scars. I slumped against the bed. I could throw fireballs all day without feeling a hint of fatigue, but healing, if I could manage it at all, sucked me dry in minutes. Anger flared through me, but not at Deanna. Damn you, Rylee, for leaving us here. At first, I'd been glad she'd left. I'd been so afraid to face her for what I'd done to Liam. But as the days, weeks, and months passed, I began to hate her for leaving us, for letting us face this hell on our own. And more than anything, because I needed her. I needed someone strong enough to help me. The darkness Giselle had said would make a bid for me. She'd been right, and now the moment had come. But someone had stepped up to help me, probably the only person who could. The only person as strong as me, and with far more experience, Millie would be the one to help me turn back the darkness, not Rylee. I lay my head next to the child I'd just healed and close my eyes. I'm just resting for a moment. Hands scoop me up, startling me, and I automatically wrap my arms around a man's neck. The ward was dark, the glow of the monitors and machines the only light. Doran held me, his face lit by the tiny blinking lights.
Come on, little witch. You've done your duty today.
He smiled, and I relaxed.
Are you finally tired enough to not demand to be put down?
I struggled half-heartedly. I can walk. Having the leader of the vampire nation pack me around was a strange thing. He took me out of the hospital and gently lowered me until my feet touched the pavement. I stumbled away from him. I'm fine.
Oh, prickly witch.
All around us, triage was set up. Deanna and what was left of her druids were healing people as best they could, without the humans getting suspicious. They took those who were just showing symptoms and cleared them of the plague, stopping at least a few points of infection. To me, it was more than futile. It was a waste of resources. I shook my head and carefully made my way to my tent, which flapped in a sudden gust of warm night wind. The summer had hit full force and the heat had gone off the charts, leaving those who were sick struggling even more. I had to give it to Orion. If he wanted to save the world, even I was ready for him to do so. I pushed my way into my tent, not bothering to seal the flap shut behind me. I wanted the breeze to come in and cool the sweat dripping down my spine, gathering at the backs of my knees. On the table in front of me were my worksheets. Deanna had me read them at every chance I got. How to nullify a vow, how to heal, how to hold an attack away from you. All things she thought I should know. I crinkled them up and tossed the bald paper across the room. Useless. The thump of a tail on the bare floor caught my attention. Alex, are you going to talk to me today? I bent to run a hand over his black fur, gently rubbing his ears. His golden eyes were dull and he shook his head. Please. 6 months, and he hadn't spoken a word. I sat down beside him. I miss her too, you know. She's probably not coming back. That was the other truth I spoke to no one but Alex. She's smart. She wants to save herself. That's why Liam died. So she could live. He pulled away from my hands, grumbling under his breath, and I froze. Maybe insulting Rylee would do the trick. Get him to finally say something. If she loved us, she wouldn't have left. She would have taken us with her. His back hunched, and the fur stood on end, his body quivering. I stood, anger rushing through me. And I realized I wasn't just saying these things to get a reaction from him. I believed them.
Rylee is a bitch. She left us here to face us all alone. Alone! I hate her!
Alex spun, lunged at me and knocked me down. I hit the ground hard. Wind knocked out of me. His mouth was right in my face. Long canines bared. But he didn't say a word.
Get off me, Alex!
I picked him up with a flick of my fingers, holding him there in the air. He tried to lunge at me again. And another piece of my heart broke.
She left us! And you would still choose her over me!
He closed his mouth. Straining against the magic holding him tight, I swiped a tear away.
Fine. Go find someone else to bother, you stupid wolf.
I put him down and pointed at the door. He stalked, stiff-legged out of the tent. I stood there, trying to bite back all the hurt that welled in me. Abandoned. Again. I fell on my cot and buried my face into the pillow, sobbing until I fell into an exhausted sleep. A hand stroked my cheek, gentle, soft, kind.
Can you hear me, Pamela?
I knew the voice, and as always, wondered how she knew when I needed her. Millie? I opened my eyes and saw I was dreaming. Millie sat beside me, wearing a long black dress cut low over her generous breasts and pulled snug through the waist, accentuated by a silver-threaded corset. We were in a sumptuous room. The bed I was on was soft, the sheets slippery under my hands. She sat on the edge, one hand on my head. A smile flickered over her lips.
I thought maybe you could use a friend.
The sob that caught in my throat spilled out as she gathered me into her arms.
Shh, child. I'm here for you. I will teach you. But you can't tell anyone, or they'll take me from you too. And we don't want that.
She stroked my hair, and I let her. As if I were a little girl instead of a nearly grown witch.
How did you know?
That you needed help? I was once in your place. And those I loved turned against me, too. Rylee, she tried to kill me. And then she took my son. I...
She bowed her head, and her shoulders shook. I wrapped my arms around her, and held her tightly as she'd done for me only moments before. She was like me. Treated wrong. Sent away. Broken-hearted.
I'll help you. I'll help you get him back.
You would do that?
Rylee doesn't care about me. Why shouldn't I help you?
Then I will train you. You will be the most powerful witch this world has ever seen. Stronger than even me.
Her eyes lit up. And for a moment, I thought I saw a glimmer of something in their depths. A writhing black snake that flicked its tongue at me. I shook my head and looked to her eyes again. No. They were the clear spring green they'd always been.
I want to learn. I want to take care of those who love me. To protect them.
But not Rylee.
No. I won't protect her anymore.
I shook my head, knowing I'd finally found my place.
There. I feel Alex and Pamela there. I pointed to the hulking gray hospital that rose up through the smog in the night sky. Can you land?
No. I will hover over the hospital roof, and you three can hop off. I won't be far. We need to go after the destroyer soon. We have less than a week, Rylee, before the veil opens and the demons pour through.
Blaz dipped low, driving through the smog, and then, in a sudden rush of wind, backwing, hovering over the hospital roof. 20 feet up, the roof looked a hell of a lot farther away. Sure, 20 feet wasn't too bad. No problem. My two companions leapt from Blaz's back, landing lightly on the roof, and I followed. I glanced at my two companions, one on 4 legs, one on 2.
Peeta!
The snow leopard's coloring made her look like a ghost. She turned her head so I could see her green eyes, even in the heavy smog.
You better do your shrinking act.
She bobbed her head, and a shudder rippled through her body. I blinked, and before me stood a gray and white house cat with a tiny white tip on the end of her tail. Only 10 pounds now instead of 400, Peeta ran toward me, leapt, and I caught her. She worked her way up to my shoulders and draped herself across them. My two-legged companion put his hands on his hips, a frown marring his handsome features.
Tracker, are you sure this is necessary? You have a week to wrap this up before the demons swarm. Your sentimentality is going to get us all killed.
His blue eyes flared in the darkness. I looked at him, giving his frown right back. You got a better idea, vampire? We need help to find the destroyer.
You're asking for backup?
Me wanting backup? Not wanting to dive into danger alone? Maybe I was growing up. Finally. Blaz's mirth floated through me.
Doubtful.
Ferris shook his head, blonde hair falling over his eyes. He wore his typical black-on-black shirt and jeans. With a brand new arm, he was as dashing as ever. But for the first time since I'd met him, he carried a weapon. A curved cutlass that hung from his hip. Very pirate-like. And it suited him. We'd come to an understanding while I'd been away to have the baby. Liam had helped him in the arm department, and that meant we were all playing nice. For now.
Sorta.
What are you staring at?
The throat of his shirt blew open with a sharp gust of wind, baring the pale flesh at his chest. Nothing. Just wondering when you're gonna turn on me this time. He put a hand to his chest, then rolled his eyes.
Ah, you wound me terribly.
Wounded my ass. A soft giggle rose behind us, startling us both. I spun, pulling a blade as I did, dropping into a crouch. Peeta let out a low growl, her tiny claws digging into my shirt. Three young children stood across from us, perhaps 2 or 3 years old at the most. I swallowed the bile rising in my throat. If they were here on the rooftop at this hour, it wouldn't be because their parents had lost track of them. I could feel the demon power running through them, twisting around them like a snake wrapping them in its coils.
Tracker, you should have stayed hidden.
The one in the middle spoke with a voice that rolled out deep and sonorous, the depth of it so totally wrong coming from a child's mouth. I swirled my blade through the air.
Can't. You demons have taken far too much already, and I'm about to kick your tiny asses into next week.
I may be an asshole, but I don't think I can kill a child.
Neither could I, but the demon didn't need to know that. I glared at Ferris.
Shut up.
His eyes widened, then narrowed.
Don't start with me, Tracker.
I moved, not toward the demons, but toward Ferris.
You do as I say on this side of the world, vampire. That's the fucking deal. I lead, you follow. Capiche?
From the corner of my eye, I could still see the children, and Ferris was eyeing them the same way.
In three.
Ferris's eyelids flicked to half-mast in agreement.
She isn't carrying the fated one. We can kill her. The master will be pleased.
The three mini-demons joined hands, and a flash of light spilled from where they touched. Their bodies melted into each other, leaving a form whose bulk heaved and lurched awkwardly as it tried to get its balance. The demon swelled and grew until it towered over us, its body sprouting mandibles and long pincers, three sets of them.
One.
Peeta leapt from my shoulders. Ferris's hand went to his cutlass.
Two.
Three.
I twisted, pulling my crossbow from my back and set a bolt into the channel in a single fluid motion. I breathed out and squeezed the handle, the bolt flying true, pinning the demon in the middle of its head, knocking it farther off balance. Ferris ran in as the demon arched backward. Ferris slammed his sword's handle into the head. The demon fell over completely, hitting the roof hard, sending out a spray of gravel from under its collapsed body. I dropped my crossbow.
Here we go.
Two of the pincers swept over my head as I ran in close. The heart was the best place to put my hands. That was what Eric had shown me. I leapt up, slicing my blade through a pincer coming from the left, and ended up landing astride the wasp waist that held the demon together. I reached up and put a hand over the barrel chest, the black exoskeleton cool under my touch.
Be free.
The demon shook under my hand. I couldn't let go. The connection to the beast drove deep as I tapped into all the love in my life and used that as the strength to send the demon back, or at least to release the children. With the veil closed, there could be no demons coming through, which was fucking awesome, but the closure went both ways. We couldn't send demons back anymore either. We could only release their hosts and hope it took them a long time to find new ones. A cloud of spinning vapors, black, gray, and flashing silver, spun up and around us, sliding through my hair.
You are a safe tracker. You are going to die. We will feast on you and your family. Orion will win.
I closed my eyes and focused on the brightness in me, the strength of heart I'd gained. I breathed in and out, thinking about the love in my life, about Liam and our daughter, her shining eyes and room-lighting, toothless smile. About Millie's child, Zane, and his sweet laughter. About Eric, Alex, Pamela, Blaz. The more names I added to my list, the more the warmth spread. A hand shook my shoulder.
The demon is gone.
I opened my eyes to see Ferris staring at me with more than a little concern on his face.
You were totally out of it. Another demon could have shown up, and if I weren't here to protect you, you could have been killed.
Ferris, the day you truly protect me will be the day hell freezes the fuck over. Ferris glared at me. I glared right back. What? It's the truth, and you damn well know it.
Things change, Rylee. You of all people should know that.
I swung my crossbow onto my back. Let's get the hell out of here. Still laying on the rooftop were the three children the demon had possessed, their tiny hands intertwined. I swallowed hard and made myself walk to them. Three brunette babies. Triplets, maybe? My whole adult life had been spent rescuing children, bringing them home to their families, and now I had resorted to killing them. It didn't matter that the cause justified it. I could never justify it. My heart clenched, and I fought the tears that threatened. I crouched beside them and put a hand on the chest of the little boy closest to me, his lungs barely lifted under my hand. Alive? They're alive. Ferris, help me! How the hell had they survived? I scooped the boy up and Ferris lifted the other two.
You seem surprised.
Eric's lessons over the last 6 months flowed through my brain.
Whether or not the host lives depends on how deeply the demons have their grip on the host and how strong the host is. Demons are tricky bastards. They seem to know how hard it is on me to see the small ones succumb to them.
Speaking of demons, you remember what Eric said, not to track them anymore.
I remembered. The last trial run I'd gone on with Eric, honing my demon-destroying abilities, had nearly ended in disaster. I'd tracked demons as a whole, searching for them so I could work on pushing them out of their host bodies. What we'd gotten was a swarm, but it had been while I was still tracking them that they'd latched on to me, and I hadn't been able to shake them. They could sense me through my tracking threads, and I could hear their thoughts. Yeah, not pleasant. I'd been able to shake them, but I could no longer track them as a whole. Even worse, the demons had somehow become able to zone in on me when I tracked anyone, so even tracking Pamela and Alex could and probably would bring Orion's minions to me. I was betting I had maybe half an hour at best before we got hit with another demon. I had more problems than I cared to think about, but I made myself list them as we packed up the kids. Find the destroyer, find a way to keep the demons from tracking me, save the world from the pox, kill Orion. And those were just the top four. Never mind all the little things popping up, like Ferris suddenly making himself my personal guardian. We carried the three kids into the hospital, Peeta leading the way, the white tip of her tail twitching the farther in we got. The children's ward. I couldn't have imagined what I was looking at, the horror of it. Babies and toddlers, covered in oozing pus, their skin broken and their eyes staring blankly as their mouths moved in silent cries. This was a morgue, and the bodies just didn't know they were dead yet. The old anger I'd nursed for years surged, and I tamped it down. As bad as this was, there was only one way to stop it. I had to finish and fulfill the prophecies. The nurses barely looked up as we stepped into the ward, their eyes dull with fatigue and hopelessness.
Where can we put them?
Anywhere you can find room.
I held the boy in my arms a little tighter, wishing I could do more than drive the demon from him. The smallpox still held him in its grip. There was a bed, empty, on my right.
Ferris!
He turned to see where I pointed. We laid the three kids down, and they snuggled against each other. Jaw tight, I strode away from the ward, my emotions warring within me. Sorrow for those who faced death with their children, and gratitude it wasn't my child lying in a bed, dying from a disease supposedly eradicated. We made it outside, and I stared, mouth hanging open in shock. The parking lot was set up like an army camp, tents and military personnel everywhere.
This is worse than we thought.
Thanks, Captain Obvious.
Knowing what had been happening was one thing. Seeing the results of said freefall was something else entirely. I had a hard time believing it could get worse, but it would. And in a damn hurry, too.
Fuck, we've got to get our asses in gear.
Peeta let out a little meow that caught my attention. Stalking toward us was a large black werewolf, teeth bared in a snarl that had saliva dripping from his mouth. Narrowed golden eyes locked onto us as his silver-tipped black fur stood on end, the tips catching the weak light from the camp. I lit up, ignoring his snarling face, and ran for him.
Alex!
His eyes widened and his mouth dropped open, the snarl falling from his face. Tears welled up and then slid down his furred cheeks as he blubbered, grabbing at me. I caught him in a hug and held him, his sides heaving under my arms.
I'm here, buddy. I'm here. I'm not going without you again.
I buried my face into his neck and breathed him in. He shook, his body trembling as he clung to me. I pulled back so I could look into his face.
Hey, aren't you gonna say anything? Didn't you miss me?
He nodded, his chest still shaking as he gasped for air, and I braced myself as his lungs filled.
Rylee's back!
Alex's howl jerked me out of sleep, and I stumbled from my tent to see him wrapped around her. Rylee. I stepped forward, a smile on my face, a huge weight lifting. She was back, and she would make things right again. And then I remembered she had left us, that she wasn't the person I thought she was, that I'd had to kill Liam because of her. She lifted her head and saw me. A smile, so rare on her face, beckoned me, and I couldn't stop moving toward her like a moth to a flame.
Pamela!
She caught me in her arms, and I fought the warring emotions. I wanted to bury my face against her and let her take care of everything that had gone wrong. All the things I'd had to face, and I wanted to hurt her, make her pay for those same things. I'm surprised you came back. She pulled back from me.
I said I'd come back.
Her tri-colored eyes took me in, and I squirmed, feeling like she could see through to my soul. Like she could see everything. Like somehow she knew I'd killed Liam.
You've grown up since I left.
She reached out and tried to touch my cheek. I jerked my head away from her hand.
Don't touch me.
Her eyebrows shot up, and I really looked at her. She seemed different, harder and softer at the same time. I couldn't put my finger on it. Or maybe it was just me. Maybe I was the one who changed. I turned my back on her.
I don't need you anymore.
The words hurt my throat. I thought about Millie. Millie was my friend. She would be the one I leaned on now.
Pamela, I still need you with me.
What for? I'm just a kid, right? That's why you left me behind. Because you didn't think you could trust me.
She'd been right not to. I'd killed Liam and then kept the truth from her. And it galled me to the core.
Look, there isn't time for this shit, kid.
Rylee grabbed my arm and spun me around.
Pamela, you are a part of my family. And family means that no matter how angry we are, we still fight for each other. No matter how fucking stupid we are, or how hurt our feelings are, we stand together. So whatever is going on, you tell me or don't. But I will be damned if you think I don't trust you.
My mouth dropped open and she let me go. But I just stood there, stunned.
Then why didn't you take me?
Liam told me who to take, and I had to trust that he was right.
She put her hands on her hips.
I left Alex behind too. I left Eve behind. Doesn't mean I don't trust you three. Just that where I was going wasn't for you.
Where did you go? She'd taken Zane, and he was wherever she'd been. and Millie wanted me to help her find him.
I don't know. My memories were taken from me to keep those I left behind safe.
It was as if Millie was right there with me, her presence real, like I could reach out and touch her. I felt her push me toward words I wouldn't have otherwise said.
You're a liar! A dirty, rotten liar!
Her eyes went wide, and I saw her tense. She shook her head.
Pam!
And then she stopped, her eyes going distant, and I recognized she was listening to Blaz. Talking about me, no doubt.
That's right! More secrets!
I stomped back to my tent. I threw myself onto my cot, the power in me erupting into a physical manifestation. The ground shook and bucked, and then, when I expected it to crack open, Millie was in my mind.
Easy, Pamela. You don't want to tip your hand. You are going to need your strength. I need you to come to me.
Her voice soothed me and helped me pull the power and anger in. She was right. I needed to conserve myself. When?
Soon. I need you to listen in to what the others are planning. Maybe you'll find out where they took my son. Then come to me.
I flopped over on the cot, tears trickling down my cheeks.
I hate them all. They hurt us both.
A gray and white cat pushed her way into the tent, ran to my bed and leapt onto it, purring. She butted her head against my chest. Warmth spread through me, and I automatically stroked her silky fur. Where did you come from? Rylee poked her head in the tent.
Peter?
I frowned at the cat. She just purred louder and curled against my chest.
Get out!
I stared at Rylee.
You may very well be the strongest witch this world has ever seen, but that doesn't mean you have to prove it every time the thought crosses your teenage brain. Peter, stick close to her, please.
I glanced down at the cat. She winked her green eyes at me. Peter, when I looked back up, Rylee was gone, and I was alone. Curling around the cat, I lay down on the bed. At least in my dreams I had a friend. A smile warmed my lips as I closed my eyes.
I couldn't believe what I was seeing with Pam. Then again, I knew what she'd been asked to do, what Liam had asked of her. Damn him for not trusting me.
Pammy's sad. Darkness is around her all the time. I sense it.
I put a hand to him, resting it on his head. Darkness?
Mm-hmm. Pammy hurt, angry, lonely. Too many things she feels.
Blaz chimed in.
She's at a crossroads. She will either choose to fight with you or against you. There's not much you can do, nor would things have been different if you had stayed. She had to face this on her own. We all must make a choice as to what path to take at some point in our lives.
I gritted my teeth, the urge to fix things strong. Ferris strode toward me, a glower on his face.
She could kill us all if she doesn't learn to control herself. I thought you said the druids were training her. They should be teaching her the healing arts, not destruction. She has that down pat.
She's always had a way with the power moves. She's a heavy hitter, not a creature of finesse. I put Pamela from my mind, knowing I would have to deal with her soon enough. Right at that moment, I needed to find Doran. He would tell me what was going on. As it turned out, he found us as we strode through the makeshift camp. One second it was just me, Ferris, and Alex. The next, Doran was beside me, a hand on my lower back.
I know you like the whole danger and doom aspect of leaving things to the last second, Rylee, but this is a bit silly even for you.
We need to talk. He tipped his head to the right.
This way.
The four of us cut through the people.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.